Good afternoon, everyone. And well, thanks for attending our webinar, which is called Lake Michigan Offshore Wind Development, Local Costs, Benefits, and Public Perceptions. So we're going to have a presentation made by Lauren Knapp. If you have questions during the presentation, you can just type them in the question box on your screen. We're going to try to answer them during the presentation and afterwards if it's more like discussion questions. So Mrs. Knapp, who are going to be our presenter today, she holds a bachelor's degree, magna cum laude, in renewable energy economics and policy from Illinois State University. In May 2013, she received her Master of Science in Environmental Policy from the University of Michigan School of Natural Resource and Environment. So this coming spring, she will start her PhD studies at the University of Delaware, where her dissertation will focus on socioeconomic dimensions of Atlantic and European offshore wind development. In the past, she has worked for the world's largest utility-scale wind developer, consulted at a clean energy policy firm, and she has worked at the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative on offshore wind proposals and community meetings. So today, she will present the results of stated preference contingent valuation study conducted in 2012 and 2013 that explored public perceptions and estimated the willingness to pay for a 400 megawatt freshwater offshore wind farm near two Lake Michigan regions. So you can go ahead.
Hey, thanks Michelle so much. Good afternoon everyone. So I'm excited to be here today to share with you some recent research regarding community perceptions and economic impacts related to offshore wind development in Lake Michigan. Like Michelle said, I worked with a couple of researchers at the University of Michigan on this project, as well as two advisors, one at the University of Michigan and another advisor we brought on board from East Carolina University. And I'll mention Craig Landry, his study later on. As well, our research, this project was commissioned essentially by three clients, the Great Lakes Commission and really the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative, University of Michigan School of Natural Resources and Environment Center for Sustainable Systems, as well as Citizens Greener Evanston, which is a nonprofit organization located north of Chicago. So our agenda today, I will start out, I'll just introduce you to the study and some of the objectives for our research. I'll just mention some of the deliverables we had as a result of this process. And I'll next talk about the survey instrument as well as show you some of our simulations that we used in the survey, which was our main mode of data collection. Then I'll show you our approaches for data analysis, as well as our key results, and conclude with discussions and final remarks. And please, I encourage you, I can get pretty technical without even realizing it. So if you have any clarifications, I encourage you to follow Michelle's instructions and pose those as I'm going throughout the slides. So back in 2008, for you not familiar with this region or previous proposals for offshore wind farms in Lake Michigan, but a wind developer proposed a two-part project near the west coast of Lake Michigan near Pentwater and Ludington. And the project was vehemently rejected subsequently by both the adjacent counties. And the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative, a couple years later, wanted to understand beyond just anecdotally people saying, well, you know, they didn't want to look at it, they didn't want this project, they thought this, they thought that. They wanted to understand Just again, beyond anecdotally, why those communities nearby rejected the project so strongly. So at the same time, around the same time, Citizens Greener Evanston had been considering the idea. They had issued requests for information, considering the idea of what it would take, what it would look like to have to essentially deploy an offshore wind farm near Evanston, Illinois, in that region, just north of Chicago. And so we worked with the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative to put together our initial project scope and in order to explore and trying to understand what are the underlying factors indicative of support or opposition for offshore wind development in Lake Michigan. So we selected these two regions. In Michigan, we went with Mason and Oceana counties, and then focused on in Illinois, Evanston, Rogers Park, and Wilmette. Now, the three main objectives we were looking to answer included to estimate resident preferences for offshore wind farm scenarios. So we wanted to test local residents' sensitivity to essentially two variables, distance from shoreline and a hypothetical price impact on their electricity bill, and how people responded to those two variables. And we selected three distances offshore, and I'll go into the rationale later why we chose those distances. And as well, we showed respondents a positive or negative price impact on their electricity bills that they might theoretically they would see as a result of the development. Our second objective, we wanted to analyze people's information sources, so how residents learned about this type of technology and through what media, and trying to understand whether or not that influenced either their current opinion and or their support for the project that we showed them. Also, demographic characteristics, age, income, et cetera, and other opinion variables that could help explain local opposition or support for this new technology. And finally, we also wanted to estimate the non-market value of the Lakeview impact. And again, this is where I can get a little technical. There's a lot of acronyms when it comes to non-market economic valuation. So again, please stop me if you need some clarification on that. So just to give you a little flavor before I dive into our research, which is focused in the Lake Michigan region. In terms of, from an economic perspective, less than a handful have studies, and within the past 5 or 10 years, have used a non-market economic valuation approach to understand why people are opposed or understand underlying factors for support or opposition for offshore wind farm development. And these are largely the three studies that we built our approach off of. So Leighton-Berg and Dubgard, they found a positive WTP is willingness to pay. Essentially, people willingness to pay is when a respondent is willing to pay an X amount for a certain type of good, and this comes into play in our scenarios, which I'll talk more about later. But in Denmark, Leighton-Berg found that residents had a positive preference to move a wind farm further from shoreline to 12, 18, or 50 kilometers relative to an 8 kilometer setback distance baseline, which ultimately suggests a visual disamenity at the closest sighting location. Now, these are notable findings because a lot of people tend to anecdotally say, well, people don't like to look at offshore wind farms But, you know, this is kind of really the first empirical evidence that suggests a disamenity at a close, relatively a close sighting distance. Kruger et al., a couple years later, utilized a choice experiment, which is essentially a scenario where you present people with options and you vary different attributes for that scenario. And then you can tease out which attributes largely drive those people decisions, those respondents' decisions. And they used a choice experiment and found an annual social cost. So this is a negative willingness to pay. Per inland Delaware residents, households for an offshore wind farm at 0.9, 3.6, 6, and 9 miles from shore. And really most recently, Landry, also a co-author of some of this research and co-advisor on this project, found from using a travel cost, so looking at respondents that don't live near the shoreline where an offshore wind farm might be, but more so looking at people that travel there for recreation. Again, another choice experiment found that while residents were averse to placement of wind turbines 1 mile from the coast, that aversion is no longer present at 4 miles, and that some respondents even consider the wind farm as value to the viewshed. I'll also note that Landry and his colleagues found some respondents actually thought that they might come back later, come back to that particular location more because they, you know, some sort of novelty effect. They wanted to see the wind farm again, so they would increase their recreational visits. Now, Landry does point out that to the extent in the future, how long that preference will persist is unknown, but it is interesting to note. And I will also add as well, all of these three main studies and ours as well, these are all fall under the umbrella of contingent valuation. So this is prospective, what respondents think they would do, how they feel that their preferences would be given the scenarios that they're presented. And this is all due in part to the fact that we do not have any offshore wind farms yet in the U.S. That will change in the near future, I'm expecting, given the DOE's next round of funding this year. So some project deliverables, we had a couple reports due to Citizen Screener Evanston last year. We presented at the 4th National Forum on Socioeconomic Research and Coastal Systems, as well as OWEA in Chicago last May. And we have two working draft journal articles. The first should be submitted to Resource and Energy Economics later this month. And also, and that's more focused on the non-market valuation, the social cost and social benefit from building this particular wind farm in our scenario. And the energy policy article should follow submission closely thereafter. So the survey instrument, we followed the typical format in the literature, didn't want to do anything out of the ordinary. I mean, while only, like I said, a handful of studies have used this type of approach, we went with generally those researchers before us and followed a very similar format. We broke up the survey into 5 sections to ease cognitive burden, and we went with a geographic systematic sampling approach. So the respondents and residents closest to the shore as well as inland had just as much a probability of being selected to participate because we wanted to avoid clustering respondents, a chance of clustering respondents that were selected to take the survey closer to the shoreline. For fear that might bias the broader picture that we are trying to paint. contact protocol was, again, standard approach. Initial priming letters were mailed out, followed with a follow-up calls and reminder postcards. Again, I don't know if I mentioned this. This was completely an online survey, and we went with the online approach for two key reasons. We had financial constraints and time constraints, but also it allowed us to randomize the order in which our offshore wind farm simulations were shown to the respondents. And I'll talk about that more in a minute. We also took a concerted effort to control for a potential response bias. Like I said, this is contingent valuation. It's not, okay, we're looking at past data and that this person and this person actually came out and voted in support, hypothetically, for building this project. We're asking people's preferences. So contingent valuation has been used, it's been an employed approach for decades now. And these are the three key controls that we use, including the self-selection bias. We followed professors at the University of Delaware, researchers there made sure in their initial priming letter not to mention anything about an offshore wind farm. It was, and we followed the same approach to avoid someone taking the priming letter and just throwing it away or choosing to respond to that survey because they felt really positively or negatively about this particular topic. So obviously once people got into the survey online and logged in, they found out quickly that it was about offshore wind farm, a hypothetical scenario near their residence, but they did not know that going into the survey. Hypothetical bias, we utilized some language right before the contingent valuation scenario, reminding respondents that we understand that this is a hypothetical, your response is, but we encourage them to keep in mind their budget and their budgetary constraints and to respond and vote as if they were actually faced with making that choice. And finally, primacy effect. Again, we randomized the order at least for half of the sample in which the simulations were shown because we didn't want to bias the respondents' decisions later on compared with the distances that they saw at first. And below is just a table of our response rates. So we worked with, initially on, we worked with a visual impact specialist at Argonne National Lab, and he gave us, he pointed us to some literature on standard guidelines for creating simulations. So we took special consideration for lighting, equipment, time of day, angle, height, etc., foreground references for scale. So this is the base view for one of our three locations for the simulations that we that respondents were presented with, and these simulations were created through some colleagues of ours. And here is the closest distance, 3 miles from shore in Pentwater, Michigan. Again, I think Michelle mentioned this is a fort. We went with a 400 megawatt offshore wind farm. So these are 85 megawatt turbines. And we chose that project scale largely due to looking at development trends in Europe, and we wanted to ensure that this might be a likely plausible project that you could see 5 or 10 years in the future, because we know that the technology is advancing rapidly, And while you know 3.5 is a typical average power capacity per turbine deployed now, we wanted to be a little more conservative on that end. And so for half, like I mentioned, half of our respondents, those in the Illinois region, they saw the 3 miles and then 6 miles and then 10 miles. And they were presented with the scenario to respond. Now, the respondents in the Illinois region, they actually saw the simulations in randomized order, and we were able to control for that in our data analysis. And so all of the respondents were presented with the wind farm scenario at their local beach and asked to vote in, either in support or against, given that distance from shore, and again, given a hypothetical price impact on their monthly electricity bill. So for our data analysis approach, we went with a random effects binary probit model in which we modeled yes, a respondent voting yes for one of those scenarios, yes, I would vote in support of this project given this distance from shore and given this electricity price impact. And we controlled for repeated measurements given that each respondent answered 3 times, and also controlled for dummy variables, including demographics, other opinions that we asked them in the survey, and again, I mentioned whether or not the respondent had a randomized simulation ordering effect. And we calculated the average willingness to pay across the entire sample. So here is a layout of the just the geographic distribution of survey respondents. This is for the Michigan region. And you can see, like I mentioned earlier, we were able to get a sample across the larger counties, again, to avoid a substantial clustering effect right on the coast and therefore potentially avoid some bias of respondents that are just on the coastline and might have different preferences than folks maybe more, residents more inland. So here's some of our initial results. This is regarding current individual opinions for offshore wind farm development in Michigan, the Michigan region on the left and Illinois region on the right. Now, there are two key trends that I'd just like to highlight, two takeaways from this slide. First, you can see roughly both locations is a similar level of current support. So approximately one-third of each region currently supports offshore wind farm development. Now, what's interesting is when you get into the undecided respondents, and more than half, you can see in the Illinois region, are undecided on the issue. But of those undecided respondents in the Illinois region, approximately half of those are leaning to support. So these graphs lay out perceptions regarding potential impacts from offshore wind farm development. Again, Michigan, just to acclimate you, Michigan respondents are on the left and Illinois on the right. And blue indicates that respondents think that particular impact, there would be a positive improvement in that particular and that particular topic, so jobs or local economy for the first there under Michigan. No impact, you'll see in yellow and red, they feel that that particular topic would worsen as a result of development. So again, what I'd like you to take away from this slide, two key takeaways. For both Michigan and Illinois regions, the largest share of people felt that jobs and the local economy would be improved as a result of development. And you can see that both are in each graph on the left-hand side. And in terms of negative impacts, the largest share of Michigan residents feel that community harmony and aesthetics of the lake view would be most negatively impacted, while in Illinois, aesthetics is their number one concern, followed closely by perceived impacts on bird life. So for our random effects probit model, we combined the two regions largely to increase the data size, and there were some initial problems with the Illinois data. So the results indicate the statistically significant effects for both of the scenario attributes. Again, that is the offshore wind farms distance from shoreline and the theoretical price impact that people might see from an offshore wind farm. So the coefficient on bid price is negative, and that indicates that the electricity rate impact variable holds an inverse relationship with a respondent's probability of support. So on average, holding all other variables constant, respondents had a less were less likely to support the scenario the higher the electricity rate impact that they saw. And we also found that strong preferences for wind farms sited further than 3 miles from shoreline. And that is the significant predictors for a wind farm 6 and 10 miles from shoreline relative to the closest distance exhibit a positive effect on support. Now, other positive statistically significant predictors include continuous household income and whether or not respondents felt that local jobs would improve. And that goes along with the findings that I mentioned to just the previous slide, and that goes along with people's inclinations of what they think impacts might be. Interestingly, respondents that support coal generation had a statistically significant lower probability of supporting the offshore wind farm scenario, holding all other variables constant. Now, here are the estimates for our average willingness to pay, which essentially to receive a 50% supportive vote for the wind, that particular wind farm sited at 3 and 6 miles offshore. The average respondent we found would need essentially to be compensated because they have a negative willingness to pay. Yet, so our results suggest respondents would pay a premium to have the wind farm sited 10 miles offshore relative to 3 miles offshore. So essentially, a social benefit would result. And it's interesting to point out that between 6 and 10 miles, the sign flips. So essentially, you wouldn't need to place the wind farm, to minimize the social cost, you wouldn't need to set back the wind farm all the way to 10 miles. But it suggests that there's some sort of some sweet spot in between 6 and 10 miles offshore. So we found much more solidified opinions in the Michigan region, and you know, we feel that perhaps this is largely due in part to the fact that those respondents had prior exposure to the Scandia Azure wind farm proposal. They had a chance to attend public meetings, to talk to their friends, perhaps read about it online, and form their opinions about the topic. The Illinois region respondents, they have not seen, at this time, they had not seen a formalized offshore wind farm proposal, so they didn't have that chance to interact with their community members or go to town hall meetings on this issue, and no formalized dialogue had been generated in the media. And that leads to perhaps why there is higher uncertainty in our illness. And our empirical findings suggest that pre-existing support for traditional, and in our case, coal electricity generation, their outlook negatively influenced preferences for our offshore wind development scenarios. But meanwhile, people think that jobs and local economy would improve as a result of this development supported our offshore wind farm scenarios. And our positive willingness to pay findings indicate that people would actually value building an offshore wind farm further than 6 miles from offshore, indicating a social benefit. And this is significant from a policy perspective because those estimates can be incorporated into the traditional cost-benefit analysis policy decision-making tool. Feel free, I'll give you my contact information on the next slide, but I can send you, there's a previous study done in Greece, and they took a similar approach and found a positive willingness to pay for an onshore wind farm, but they then actually took the next step and they incorporated those estimates into a cost-benefit analysis and found that under all of their discount rate scenarios that the project should be built given the positive preferences that people elicited in that particular study. So it's quite interesting. And I would just leave in that education is critical. You saw the high degree of uncertainty in the Illinois region. I think now is the time for people to understand the complexity of the issues surrounding this type of development and what that means to their communities, both temporally, as well as have an avenue to pose questions like this and learn more about what potential impacts might be. And if you have any questions, please contact me. This is my email starting next month. Myself and my co-authors are going to be submitting this journal article later this month for review, and we hope to get it published soon thereafter. So if you'd like to see it as soon as it's hot off the press, please do keep in touch, and I'll answer any questions you have right now.
Well, thank you very much, Lauren. So if you have any questions, don't hesitate. Please type them in the question box. So while we're reading, if someone has questions, I have a little question for you. I was wondering, all the results you got from your research, are they like similar to what you could have anticipated as results, or is it like very different than what you thought it would be?
Yeah, so that's a good question, Michelle. Earlier I had mentioned, and I'll go back to this slide, let's see here. I had mentioned that one of our statistically significant variable for our probit model had a positive impact on respondent support, here we go. Was continuous household income. Now we had this, how it ended up, the coefficient actually for income and more largely education, it looks a little different than the previous research done, those that I'd mentioned earlier, and specifically another publication from Firestone and some of his, Professor Firestone and some of his colleagues at the University of Delaware. So some of the predictors had a slightly different sign than we had anticipated, and again, most notably, education. Also, I think I mentioned it, but we controlled for the simulation ordering effects, and that did not end up having a statistically significant impact on whether or not people would support the project. So those were removed. I had anticipated potentially some impact. So say if someone was presented with the wind farm that for 3 miles and asked if they supported it, and then 6 miles and 10 miles, then that might they might be more supportive of the 10 mile distance than someone who saw the reverse order, but that didn't end up having any statistical significance. And also, interestingly, the information sources in the random effects probit model didn't have any statistically significant impact on our on the probability of support as well, either positive or negative. So we did end up backstepping those variables out of the model, but they are interesting to look at separately. And I don't have those results here, but again, if anyone wants to look at that, please reach out to me. And we were able to collect a little bit of information on the extent of which people learned about offshore wind farms, say, from reading online. But again, that wasn't statistically significant either. So yeah, so a couple of surprising results.
I have two questions here.
Yeah.
Do you think that, like, the size of the wind farm could have an impact also on the results, like if you use either smaller turbines or fewer turbines?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And that's why we wanted to be cautious in the size of the wind farm that we went with. Again, we presented respondents with 5 megawatt turbines, 80 of those for a total of a 400 megawatt project. And we could have gone to a smaller project. The initial one proposed in that region, in the West Michigan region, was 500. So in terms of that, we actually stepped it down a little bit. But we wanted to be as conservative as possible. But absolutely, the scale of the, and I'll go back to the simulations, the scale of the project no doubt influenced how people respond to that scenario, because they were responding whether or not potentially, hypothetically, they would support that project given the simulation that we showed them. So something that we weren't able to do, unfortunately, and we were advised early on, but we weren't able to do because of, like I mentioned, financial and time constraints. But ideally, and researchers at the University of Delaware and other universities are doing this, is to show these simulations so you can actually see the turbines moving. And potentially playing around with the layout as well. You'll notice that we went with kind of a traditional, more geographic layout, but I think visual impact specialists will be the first to point out that depending on even how the turbines are laid out could potentially have an impact on or could potentially influence the visual impact. So yeah, so we thought about all of that, but the CH2M Hill visual engineers that generated these simulations, they use the Premier WinPro software to create these simulations. And we followed all the protocol necessary, but absolutely the scale and height and size of the turbine is definitely critical in this step.
Great. And another question: have you thought to see if there was difference in the perception from people living on the shore compared to people living more inland? Have you seen differences between where people were actually living?
Right, that is a great question. So our data we were able to collect individual household data and their distance from shorelines, so whether or not someone lives right on the beach or someone lives 10 miles from the beach. We didn't incorporate that because we didn't have enough observations. People were, I think, a little hesitant to mark on our map exactly where they lived. We assured them that their responses would remain anonymous. But I think what we will be able to do, at least in the energy policy paper, is cluster out and break out those responses for more nearshore, more inland responses. But the results I presented today are not broken down comparatively, either within regions nearshore or more inland, or across regions.
And what about, you looked at it, but the education level, not on this issue, but education level in general of the person who enters, of the participants, mm-hmm. could there be a correlation between the education level and the perception? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's what I mentioned earlier. We did control for that, so whether respondents, their level of education, highest level of education. And that was one of those I mentioned that was a little surprising because it didn't quite follow what other researchers have found. I think it goes to show that a lot of these issues and these perceptions, I would argue, and other researchers have as well, are very region and site specific. As well, we felt that we thought that potentially people might have a greater attachment and therefore resistance to this type of technology, attachment to the Great Lakes, and that unfortunately that variable didn't end up being statistically significant, at least in our probit model analysis. But definitely, individual education, not just on the issue, but more generally, we controlled for and found some slight statistically significant results.
Right, thanks. Another question we have here, someone was asking, have you seen in your literature review,
yes.
any projects have been implemented based on social acceptance research? Where the actual public support matched or did not match what the research results of that community? Like, have you ever seen project that went ahead only on public acceptance?
I gotcha. Not that I'm aware of. Again, we still don't have any offshore wind farms here in the U.S., both in saltwater or in marine environments or freshwater environments, and as well these specifically the non-market valuation and more generally public perception offshore wind studies are still relatively new in the literature. Now, I think what our European colleagues have an opportunity to do now, though, is that they have been able to look at public perception, and in some cases, Ladenburg been able to estimate the social cost, social benefit from building those projects, and now they've had the experience and are having the experience in terms of proposal, deployment, construction, and now operation and maintenance. They're a little bit more ahead in the game in that now they can look back retroactively and compare, just due to the nature of the industry here in the States, we don't have that opportunity yet. But more specifically, no, I haven't seen a study looking at prospectively, what are the social costs, social benefits, then deploying that project, then looking back and seeing if those results match up that I think those will be really interesting results, though.
Cool. And talking about public perception, do you know if the public perception have changed in Europe where they have offshore wind farms? Is public more or less accepting of it?
Well, yeah, so I think, so let's take Scotland, for example. Scotland is extremely bullish on offshore wind development, both onshore and offshore. They have a target by 2020 to reach 100% renewable energy equivalent for their load by 2020. Extremely ambitious goal. And, you know, they highly value their lands and the aesthetic view on land. And initially a lot of people were thinking, well, you just move the onshore turbines, which there's a lot of development onshore. You move it offshore, it could help minimize a lot of that impact, resistance, et cetera. And at least in some of the initial studies, they're finding that's really not the case. Case in point, not Scotsman himself, but the Donald Trump example and all the controversy that surrounded that there. But I think obviously generally they're more as a whole, again generally, they're more accepting than we are here. And but I think even, you know, people are bringing up now at what point is there some sort of saturation point. You know, I was in university talking with a researcher at University of Edinburgh last fall, and you know, he, social scientist, he brought up this point about, you know, at some point, both onshore and offshore, you know, at least he was thinking, is there some sort of saturation point where you see wind turbines all around you. So, you know, I don't know if that particular his particular outlook is reflective of the more broader population, but those are just some of the questions, you know, that they're thinking about now.
Great. And if you were to search community, you know, directed this time, like in the community gathering, just to gauge a little bit what the receptivity to offshore wind, how would you go about it? How could you manage to get people from different horizons, different education level? How could you, like, have a way to give us a little tip on how to get to these people?
Oh yeah. Oh gosh, that's a big feat. Well, I would suggest, and we had, you mentioned, you know, when I worked here briefly last year with the Wind Collaborative in Victoria, we held some community meetings about this particular topic, and I think it's really important to approach it more. And this is what we did. We approached it more as having a dialogue on the issue. It was very interactive. People feedback. We included a lot of simulations. Again, because, you know, someone can see a wind turbine, a utility scale size wind turbine onshore, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they'll know what it looks like offshore. And it doesn't. Or there are a lot of people that haven't even seen this type of technology onshore, and therefore will, you know, have a really hard time picturing what it might look like in the water. And I think that's critical. And again, that's why I mentioned, I think, you know, researchers now and my research in the future, if I have to say it, will make sure that you know, this, given that this technology is so is new and people aren't familiar with it here in the States, that visual 3D simulation are critical to use, as well as giving people an idea of what it might look like at night. I remember in one of our community meetings, we showed a night display, and people were a little surprised because they weren't expecting, you know, because there are some navigation lights there. And but I think, you know, visual simulations are critical, having more of an open dialogue, you know, not trying to push an agenda, but really offering people an avenue to voice their opinions and just gather more information.
Great. We have another little technical question.
Yeah.
About want to talk about the job and economic impact.
Mm-hmm.
Did you provide any specific scenarios to respondents or about the job or the impact? Or it's just like, let's say they think it's going to be positive. Is it only on their side, or do you have scenarios presented to them?
Right, right. Yeah, so that's a good question. In those perceived impacts, no, we didn't tell, that's just based off of what people think might happen as a result of the development. So that's just general, you know, people going into it, again, still very uncertain about this technology because they haven't seen it in person, most likely, just what they think, given what they know, they've read online or, you know, talked with their colleagues, neighbors about what they think might potentially happen. So just their initial inclination.
Great. And we have one last question, kind of a wrap-up question maybe. I want to ask you, what surprised you the most in conducting this research? What was the most surprising thing you learned about public perception?
I think what's the most surprising, and I think one of our most significant results was going back to the average willingness to pay. It wasn't quite surprising to me that people would be supportive of the wind farm, but in our scenarios, but they'd have to be compensated, or there's a negative social cost at the close distances. I think we already saw some initial evidence of that from Leidenberg and other researchers, Kruger et al. But I think what is a little surprising is that the sign actually flipped, and that there would be a social benefit, at least from our results, we found empirically suggests if the wind farm is built further, a little bit further than 6 miles offshore. So it's interesting because that's what the Great Lakes Offshore Wind Council recommended. The State of Michigan Council several years ago was a minimum setback of 6 miles offshore, so it kind of coincides with that, their initial recommendation. And I actually wasn't anticipating that at all, but it is interesting to see how region specific it is. Again, Landry et al., the Carolina Coast found that at 4 miles, there was no longer an aversion to the turbines at 4 miles offshore. So it is very region specific. I think that these studies really play a critical importance in helping people understand the issues and hopefully aiding policy making in the future going forward.
Great. Well, that's going to wrap up our presentation. So I'm just going to put the last slide. Again, okay. So have your coordinates, your email address, so if anyone wants to reach you. Okay. Sorry about that, my computer decided to be a little slow. So we're going to put a recording of the presentation on our website as soon as possible, as well as the PDF presentation. If you have any question, you can either send an email to us at the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative or to Lauren directly. Okay, perfect. So her email will be there. So on the email you see on the screen right now. So don't forget, you can still know what's happening with the Great Lakes Wind Collaborative by through our Facebook, our Twitter account, and through our whole new website. Ending to this presentation. Thank you a lot, Lauren, for your presentation.
Thanks, Tasha.
And hopefully we'll see you next time.